Hello everyone, and welcome to the first online GoodoCon. My name is Fabio Lassandrelli, aka Falas, and today I'm gonna talk to you about Godot games and apps on the web. Let me introduce myself. I'm a computer scientist, I've worked as a full-stack developer for many years, and I've been working with Godot and on Godot since 2015. I'm currently the maintainer of the networking stack and the HTML5 expert of Godot. The goal of this presentation is to define what the HTML5 platform is and help you evaluate if exporting to the web is suitable for your game. Ensure that players on the web have a great experience with your game. So let's start with defining what the HTML5 platform is, or should we say the web platform maybe. We'll see why. Let's start with HTML. HTML was the language, markup language of the web. It was created as a way to displaying documents inside the browser, or a way to share documents in a highly compatible way, basing it on standard technologies. But, of course, that was in the 90s. Then came the idea that we could do more with the web, and the idea that you could actually create interactive web pages, and what we now call web applications. So JavaScript was born as the programming language of the web. It wasn't called JavaScript in the beginning, and it took a while before it was kind of standardized. But it slowly became the interface for many web technologies, from audio to WebGL to accessing inputs and so on. The problem, as I said, was that it took a while to become what it is now, and it was, and it still is, somehow fragmented. It also is by conception, single threaded, which means doing long-running operation is kind of problematic, and it's also not very performant. So in the picture, you can see a music player with the full spectrum analyzer running in Firefox, so inside the browser. This is what JavaScript brought to the table. And then the new thing, WebAssembly. And the idea is to have an assembler of the web, something that is easy to interpret and execute, and with simple instructions to execute. Something that you can write your code in any compiled programming language you like, and then compile it to WebAssembly as a target platform for compilers. And the idea is that will bring high performances and a multi-threaded environment to the web. And the idea is also that toolchains kind of bridge the gap between what WebAssembly can do and the JavaScript APIs. Now let's talk about browsers. The browser is the application the user run to play your game, to run your application. So your HTML5 application, your web application. So let's see what they can do and what is the underlying problem with them or issue with them. The issue is that users want a system that is at the same time secure and compliant. Secure meaning they shouldn't catch malware just by visiting a web page. They also want a system that is privacy oriented, which means that visiting a web page should not let the owner of the web page to know too much about the user. Anything that is unrelated to the operation of the website should not be known by whoever run the website. And it should also be sandboxed, which means every application running inside the browser should be completely isolated from the others, and from the system itself, from the underlying operating system itself, to preserve things like credentials and sensitive data and so on. But they also want a system that is complete, meaning it should support web applications, full applications, and they expect them to be able to access device features like from accelerometer on the phone to geolocation data and so on. And they also want or expect that applications performs like native applications, which is most often not the case. So let's talk a little bit about security and introduce the concept of secure context. A secure context is a window or a web page for which a certain minimum standards of authentication and confidentiality are met. This is the definition from the Mozilla Developer Network web docs. And they also say many web APIs and features are only accessible in secure context. That means that many features like gamepad, access to gamepad, or some audio features are only available in a secure context. And the reason for that is that a secure context ideally protects the user from man-in-the-middle attacks, which means someone intercepting your communication between you and the server and basically reading your data. It also helps protect user sensitive data, user privacy, because you might have decided to share some privacy information with a specific web page. But if someone is in the middle and can read everything, then it can pass. It can read those privacy sensitive information. And the minimum requirement for this, there might be a little more, but it basically breaks down to properly supporting HTTPS. Luckily, now it's easier to get a certificate for your domain with Let's Encrypt, or with initiative like Let's Encrypt and so on. Let's talk about saving persistent files. One of the features that are a bit complicated on the web is basically accessing the user file system, meaning you don't really have direct access to the user file system. The reason for that is, again, privacy and security. You don't want to visit a web page and then have your data stolen. So internally, Godot uses IndexedDB, which is a way to save persistent information inside the browser, but it's not easy to then extract data from there for the user. So, and it also does not work in strict privacy modes, like incognito mode and so on. So it's a good idea to let users download files on their device and then upload them back. If you have save game saves or stuff like that, or configurations and so on, it could be a really nice feature to have. And so this is, for example, Pixelorama running in Firefox. Pixelorama is a sprite editor, pixel art creator made with Godot, and that runs also on the HTML5 platform. There are also some limitations about inputs, and inputs are very important on the web platform itself, meaning some actions can only be triggered by user input. So you cannot go full screen in a web page if the user hasn't pressed the button. You cannot capture the mouse and lock the mouse if the user hasn't pressed the mouse button on your web page. This is again for security reasons, because you don't want applications to be able to capture the mouse maybe when it's doing something sensitive on the web and trick the user into doing something that by creating a fake mouse or something like that. The same thing also applies, for example, for accessing the operating system clipboard. You can access it on some systems, mostly Chrome for now, but again, it must be requested during an input, a user-generated input, and users also have to allow permissions for that. Because, again, maybe you have in your clipboard your password, you should never do that, but it might happen. And you visit a web page, and now they read your clipboard, and now they have your password. As easy as that. So that's why it's not allowed on the web. Also, some features are not supported, like mouse wrapping, like moving the mouse around. You can't. You're not allowed to do that for the same security reason as explained before. And gamepads cannot be detected until a user presses a button. So always, like, if you have a menu that of some kind, an interface of some kind that tells the user which device to use, do not expect them to always show up. Be ready to listen to Joy Connected event and tell the user press a button so we can detect it. Almost all of this requires a secure context, which is why, again, I explain why it's important to share web applications with HTTPS. And it's very important about inputs, and this is really important. Don't do computation intensive operation during input callbacks. Input, unhandled input, GUI input, do only do lightweight operations there, because inputs on the HTML5 platform are not clamped together. They come as they arrive from the browser, so you can get a lot of them in succession. And the reason they're not clamped together is because otherwise you wouldn't be able to trigger things like full screen, mouse capture, access to ice clipboard, and so on. Networking is also tricky. You might think it's easy because they are browsers, so they work on the web, but they always came with a lot of limitation. And originally, it was only HTTP, meaning you could only request HTTP page. You still have no low-level access, like no direct TCP or UDP, so Inet won't work and stuff like that. But there is now WebSocket and WebRTC, which are web technologies that can also run on native applications. So if you're making a multiplayer game and you are targeting the web platform, make sure you can run either your multiplayer on WebSocket or WebRTC. WebSocket is very good for time-based game. You have to host the server if all the users are running on the web. WebRTC is even better because you can run pretty much everything on the client. You only need the server for basically the matchmaking part, which in WebRTC is called signaling, but you can kind of the same thing. And also be mindful that the HTTP classes cannot access data before the transfer is complete. This is a limitation of the underlying browser interface for it. There isn't much we can do about it. And it is also subject to calls, which means most of the time you are not allowed to request an HTTP page from a browser to a different domain, unless that specific domain allows it. And the reason for that is that browsers typically carry credentials. And again, you don't want, by visiting a web page, that web page can make a call to, let's say, Google, Gmail, and since it's from your browser and your browser is authenticated with Gmail, read your emails, which is why calls exist. And most of the time, you're not allowed to do HTTP calls outside of your domain, unless it's a public API or something that is specifically allowed. And then mobile. Mobile support on the HTML5 platform is still subpar. Supporting virtual keyboards is painful. I've been trying. Probably the best thing you can do is write your own virtual keyboard in Godot, honestly, right now, because the API is not ready yet, and browser, it's still being drafted for accessing the virtual keyboard, the actual virtual keyboard of the device. You will need custom controls. Again, probably you want to write a virtual keyboard. You can also rely on JavaScript prompt created with Evil, but it still sucks. And you need some custom controls for buttons, of course. That's normal on mobile. Performances are not usually really good, but it can work for your game. If the scope of your game is a simple turn-based game, for example, it could actually work. Performances are not super good, but also not super bad. And optimizations here become crucial. So we'll talk about optimization in a bit. So as you've seen, there's quite a few limitations and things you have to consider when you want to release an HTML5 game. So it's very important that you define your scope very well when you begin this process. Is it going to be a desktop game or a mobile game? Does your game require high performance hardware, or does it have low requirements, and can it potentially run also low performance? So that will define a bunch of your choices going on. So the first choice is which kind of build type to use. Since the latest beta, Godot now supports three different kind of build types for JavaScript. The regular, GD native, and grids. The regular is the most compatible one, is the same that it was is being used up until now, and it doesn't have great performances. The GD native build allows you to run also GD native code. So write your own C, C++ code, and then compile it to WebAssembly and run it on the web. So it kind of bridges the gap with games that need third-party GD native plugins or written in different languages. This one also is like the regular one, doesn't have great performances, but allows you to make ports of your game if your game depends on GD native, which is really important. And then there's the third type, which is the future, the treated build. For now, only desktop browser supports it, but in the future, support should expand in this year, the next couple of years. So it's also much more performant, both in terms of audio, potentially on rendering, and also allows you to do interactive loading or 3D that we love. A few things about rendering. There are, in Godot 3.2, there are two options for rendering, GLES2 and GLES3. GLES2 is rendered is translated to WebGL and is supported by almost every browser, including on mobile. GLES3 translates to WebGL2. It gives you much higher quality, it's not so well supported, notably by Safari. Luckily, there's WebGL2 is getting some more love from Safari, from the WebKit project, and it seems to be running pretty smoothly. So we expect it to be shipped hopefully this year. So potentially in Godot 4.0, we will have a GLES3 renderer for high compatibility. There's been talk about it, but it's still not defined. And there's also talks about WebGPU, which is the next standard for graphics on the web. But again, this will require some time. So here are the choices between, for now, GLES2, especially if you want to target mobile, or GLES3, if you want to target desktop only and you want high quality. So you can see in the picture the Godot third-party shooter demo running in Firefox using the Threads build and the GLES3. Again, at a decent frame rate, even on my 6 years old video card. Last but not least, audio. There's been a lot of issues about audio. in the HTML5 platform. The problem, once again, is that JavaScript is single-threaded, so up until very recently, there's been no way to take the audio processing out of the main thread, which also meant that whenever you were doing loading or you would lose frames per second, the audio would crackle. Now the threads build finally have a much better audio quality, and even if your FPS drops to really low, you won't see crackles or audio stopping and so on. If you can't use the threads build, and in any case, you can try to adjust the latency trade-off in project settings audio. Raising the latency will make, of course, every sound start a bit later, but it should also help when you get frame time spikes. So sometimes you get a frame drop for a second and then it goes up again. So if you have higher light latency, that will help in that sense. And really, this is really important. Follow the recommendations about lightweight inputs. If you do a lot of EV operations during inputs, when the user moves the mouse on the screen and you're not running the threads build, the audio will crackle always. This is again a limitation of the platform itself. But if you know how it works, it's also not so hard to work around, right? Now we are reaching the end. Let's say a few words about delivering your game. So always remember that the bug builds sucks. They are really slow. They are the bug builds for a reason. They make a lot of extra checks. They are great for showing you where the error here is, but it's not something that you should deliver to your user because the performances are going to suck and it's going to be even worse on the web. Size matters, which means the size of your binaries or your files and your data pack, your game assets matters because the users will have to download those files, right? And if they are small, browsers will cache them. But if they are too big, browsers will kind of tend to evict them from the cache quite often. And users will have to re-download it. And of course, the download time is added to the time to first interaction. So the time it takes for the user to actually try your game and get engaged. And for the same reason, the hosting server speed also matter, because if the hosting server is slow to serve that file, slower than the connection that the user have, of course, they will get their game later and it will take longer for them to try it out and get engaged. So optimizations are more important than ever. So serving the files the proper way is very important because HTML5 builds are easy to distribute, but as I explained, HTTPS is a must or some features just won't work. You have to keep in mind that threads build requires extra server headers for security. Most hosters now expose those headers. If you host it yourself, you should make sure that you expose those headers. The actual headers are documented in the Godot documentation. You can check it out about exporting for the web. So compressing, as I mentioned before, since size matters, compressing the files is important. And some hosts don't. Some hosts allow you to compress, pre-compress the file statically and serve them along with the regular files. So if the browser support compression, then the compressed files will be downloaded instead of the regular one. And most of the browsers do support compression, and compression can take the size of your game down to half the size or less than a third of the size of the total game, which means a third of the load time for the user. Again, this is explained in a bit more details. I don't want to bother you here in the documentation, but it's something that you have to keep in mind because it's going to greatly improve your game time to first interaction. if you want to squeeze the maximum out of it, you should also consider rebuilding the engine and the exporter plate with the modules you don't need disabled, and that will allow you to make very small builds, something like few megabytes, like 2-3 megabytes build of the engine, which is going to be faster and much faster to load. And I agree that customizing the HTML page should be simpler. We'll be working on that too. So this is pretty much it. I hope I helped you understand some of the tricks around making great HTML5 games and porting your game to HTML5. If you have any questions,